Game of Thrones missing cast members. After going over the major characters a couple of months ago, we're going to dive into the minor characters that were cut today. And don't worry, I'm not going to just name all of them in chronological order, because not all of A Song of Ice and Fire's characters were created equally. But I believe quite a lot of them would have added to the already existing cast and story of Game of Thrones. Some because they provide interesting lore and backstories. Some because their existence solves some unexplainable situations in the series. And some because they are simply colorful characters. Adding to that, in some cases I've chosen to combine multiple people because they wouldn't warrant a placing of their own. Which is immediately the case for our number 5. Because we're going to start with the missing Tyrells. Loras' story was heavily altered to accommodate the disappearance of his two older brothers, Willas and Garlan. Willas is the oldest and heir to Highgarden and the Reach. And Garlan is Mace's second son. Loras takes over most of the story that was left vacant by the omission of these two characters. In Game of Thrones, it's Loras who the Tyrells try to marry to Sansa, instead of Willas in the books. And it's Loras that fights the Battle of the Blackwater in Renly's armor instead of Garlan. And although it is never properly explained in the show, having Garlan fight the battle in Renly's armor was a deliberate ploy to break the morale of Renly's former bannermen who had gone over to Stannis. And it worked, as many of them threw down their weapons upon seeing Garlan during the battle because they thought Renly had come back from the dead to enact his revenge. This is not super relevant for this video, but it is a fun fact to share. So, what did we miss? For Garlan, not that much. If the stories are to be believed, he is one of the most gifted swordsmen in the kingdoms, being even better than his younger brother Loras. But we have quite a few excellent fighters already, so one more or less would not have made the difference. Garlan also plays a role in the story of House Florent, as he is named the new lord of Brightwater Keep after the Lannister Tyrell victory against Stannis. But at the end of A Dance with Dragons, he hasn't taken the castle yet. And with almost the entirety of House Florent also having been cut from Game of Thrones, this part of his story is better discussed when we discuss the Florents in a future installment of this series. On to Willas, whose absence means a lot of show watchers missed out on some very interesting lore concerning the relationship between Houses Tyrell and Martell. Historically, Dorne and the Reach have always been hostile towards each other. The enmity started with thousands of years of fighting between the Dornish and the Reachmen in the time of the Gardener Kings. After Aegon's conquest, frequent border skirmishes between the two kingdoms would continue. When Daeron Targaryen, the Young Dragon, conquered Dorne in 158 AC, he installed Lord Lyonel Tyrell as steward to keep the peace. Within a year, Lyonel was murdered while visiting the castle of Sandstone. Olenna mentions her ancestor during her meeting with Alaria and the Sandsnakes, which is the only reference to the enmity between the two houses we get in Game of Thrones. And after many years of relative peace between the two regions, it was a situation concerning Willas that would renew the feud between them. When Willas was a young boy, his father pushed him to compete in a tourney, wanting his son to achieve glory in the lists. Willas had to ride against Oberyn Martell, who was several years older than he was. Oberyn knocked him off his horse, Willas' foot caught in the stirrups, and his horse crushed his leg during the fall. This made Willas a cripple, and any dreams of knighthood had to be abandoned. The Tyrells have always been convinced that Oberyn crippled Willas on purpose. While Oberyn simply states that Mace should not have pushed his son to compete in a tourney at that young of an age. And this mischance once again ignited the bad blood between houses Martell and Tyrell. Despite their history, Willas bears Oberyn no ill will, and the two have been in correspondence for many years because of their shared passion for horseflesh. Willas is everything his father is not. He is highly intelligent, likes to read books, and is known for breeding the finest hounds, hawks, and horses in the Seven Kingdoms. Olenna may think her son Mace to be a fat oaf, she has a lot of respect for her grandson. Willas hasn't physically entered the story yet in the books, but his existence would have given us a cool piece of lore regarding the relations between Dorne and the Reach. And for that reason, it's a shame he was cut. The number 4 on this list is Donal Noy. Donal is the smith and armorer for the Night's Watch at Castle Black. Donal is one of the more prominent of the Black Brothers in the books, and the most important parts of his story are taken over by other characters. His speech about Jon not being better than the other recruits is taken over by Tyrion. His command of the Wall during the first Wildling attack is taken over by Alistair Thorne. And his epic fight with Mag the Mighty, the King of the Giants, is taken over by Gren and 5 other Black Brothers. So it's not Donal's story that we are missing. It's his background story. Donal used to be sworn to House Baratheon and he smitted at Storm's End. He made Stannis Baratheon's first sword, and he forged Robert's legendary Warhammer, the weapon that would kill Rhaegar Targaryen and decide the War of the Usurper. During the siege of Storm's End, Donal lost an arm while fighting, and only then did he decide, after a life of fighting, wenching and seeing the Seven Kingdoms from north to south, to come to the Wall. Which makes this lowborn character's backstory very interesting. The blacksmith who forged the weapon that ended the Targaryen dynasty, who while being one-handed, killed the last of the giants. Donal's extensive knowledge of the Baratheon brothers also gives us the following quote, which sadly did not make it into the show. "Robert was the true steel. Stannis is pure iron. Black and hard and strong, yes, but brittle. The way iron gets. He'll break before he bends. And Renly, that one, he's copper. Bright and shiny. Pretty to look at, but not worth all that much at the end of the day." Which, as far as we know at this point in the books, turned out to be mostly correct, showing that Donal was an excellent judge of character as well. And while Donal Noy was only one character that we missed in the series, the number 3 on this list is an entire house. And if you are enjoying this video and don't want to miss the next one, please consider subscribing to the channel and leaving a like so the video can get some traction. We just surpassed my goal of 2500 subscribers and I want to thank every single one of you for your support. My next goal is 5000 subscribers, which still is quite a bit to go, but your help in getting there is very much appreciated. Thank you very much. Our next entry is House Farwind of the Lonely Light. They play a very minimal role in the story, but it's the tale surrounding the house that would have made them a cool addition for the show. House Farwind is one of the noble houses of the Iron Islands. They briefly enter the story during the Kingsmoot, when Lord Gilbert Farwind puts forth his name as the next king of the Iron Islands. He is championed by his sons Giles, Aegon and Jon. His gifts are considered poor and his words mad, as he promises to take the Ironborn to lands beyond the Sunset Sea, where every man would be a king and every wife a queen. House Farwind's keep, the Lonely Light, is found on a group of 13 rocky islands situated 8 days west by sail from the main group of the Iron Islands. This makes the Lonely Light the westernmost territory of the Seven Kingdoms. Because of this distance between them and the other noble houses of the Iron Islands, the Farwinds and their small folk are considered as strange by the other Iron Islanders. Some tales say that they lay with seals to bring forth half-human children. Other tales claim that the Farwinds are skin changers, being able to take the form of sea lions, walruses and spotted whales at will. How much of this is true will probably remain a mystery to us, as the Farwinds are not expected to play any role in the story of the last 2 books. And although they don't play a major role in the story, this interesting bit of lore surrounding House Farwind would have been a very cool addition to the world building of the show. And for the number 2 on this list, we're moving back north, to Barrowton to be precise. Because our next entry is Lady Barbary Dustin. Lady Barbary is a great example that not all of the north was united in their praise of Ned Stark. In her youth, Barbary had an affair with Brandon Stark, Eddard's older brother. She loved him and gave him her maidenhead, and Brandon loved her as well, according to Barbary. She wanted nothing more than to marry Brandon, but at the advice of his maester, Lord Rickard Stark decided to marry his heir to Catelyn Tully of Riverrun. Barbree has had an intense hate for maesters ever since. She would eventually be married to William Dustin, the young lord of Barrowton. But only 6 months after their marriage, Ned Stark called the banners for Robert's Rebellion. Barbree gifted her husband the finest steed out of her father's herd, and Lord William rode off into war. William Dustin was one of Ned's companions at the Tower of Joy, where he traveled to free his sister Lyanna. And since most of us know that the fight at the Tower of Joy had no survivors save Ned and Howland Reed, William died in Dorne. Ned buried his companions at the Tower of Joy, but brought his sister's bones back to Winterfell, and Lady Barbree has never forgiven him for this. Lady Barbree is a vengeful woman. She is one of the main reasons that houses Dustin and Riswell, her father's house, staunchly support the Boltons when they take over power in the north. And she is dead set on making sure that Eddard Stark's bones, who have been sent north by Tyrion as a gesture of goodwill, will never reach Winterfell, denying Eddard Stark his final resting place, as has happened to her late husband. Lady Barbree is one of the more important political players in the north after the fall of House Stark. She plays a big role in the plot to marry fake Arya to Ramsay Bolton, to cement the Boltons' claim over the north. And she is one of the only people that treats Theon like a human being after he has been transformed into Reek. But maybe her most interesting interactions are with Ramsay, who she despises because she suspects him to have had a hand in the death of her nephew, Domerick Bolton. She even forbids Ramsay from entering Barrow Hall when she is hosting the Boltons. All in all, Lady Barbree is a very interesting character that shows us the Northern allegiances are not as one-dimensional as they may seem to be. And the fact that she was cut, and with her the greater part of the Northern storyline under House Bolton, truly is a shame. Which brings us to the number one of this video, which is a character that officially is in the series. But she's also not, because our last entry is Lady Stoneheart, which is Catelyn Stark's new moniker after she gets resurrected. Let's start with the part of her story that we still get to see. As we know, Catelyn Stark is killed by the Freys at the Red Wedding. To mock the Tully funeral rites, they dump her naked body in the Green Fork of the Trident. 3 days later, her body is found by the Brotherhood without banners. Beric Dondarrion asks Tauros to revive Catelyn, but the Red Priest is not willing to do this as, according to him, too much time since her death has passed. Beric then decides to give Catelyn the kiss of life himself, trading his own life for hers. He succeeds. Beric dies his 8th and final death, and Catelyn Tully is revived as Lady Stoneheart. Because she had been dead for multiple days and her body had been in water, she retains little of her former appearance. Her skin has become white and is rotting in places. Half her hair is gone, and the hair she does have has turned white. Her eyes have turned into 2 red pits. Her skin is hanging from her cheeks, even showing bone, and she is no longer able to speak, courtesy of the Freys slitting her throat. With Lady Stoneheart, the Brotherhood's objectives turn a lot less noble. Under her leadership, their main goal becomes punishing any person who was involved in the Red Wedding, or more broadly, every person with a connection to Houses Lannister, Bolton, or Frey. They successfully kill multiple Freys in the story, and at the very end they capture Brienne of Tarth and Podrick Payne. Lady Stoneheart sees them as traitors, as Brienne is armed with Oathbreaker, and decides to hang them both. But a couple of seconds before the rope is cut, the chapter ends, and we have been waiting for more than a decade to see what happens to them. And yes, I know there is a sample chapter from The Winds of Winter that elaborates a bit on this storyline, but out of fear for spoilers, I will not discuss that chapter here. Lady Stoneheart's story has not had its time to fully evolve in the books yet, but I would have loved to see how her story would develop in the series. Why does Beric give his life for hers? What role is she going to play in the fight against the Boltons and Freys? And will the Brotherhood still follow her if she is only led by vengeance? It truly is a shame we didn't get to see the answers to these questions in Game of Thrones. so let's hope we'll get them in The Winds of Winter when it is published in the upcoming years. I hope. And those are five awesome minor characters we missed in Game of Thrones. I have so many character names written down that I think I could make 10 more parts of this series. So let me know if you liked it, and I'll start working on part 2. In the meantime, I'm curious as to which minor character you missed most in Game of Thrones. Please let me know in the comments. As always, thank you guys very much for watching. See you next time.